Good day. So, as shown, today we'll talk about the response of a bank of correlators. I hope you remember the correlation receiver structure. We are talking about that bank of correlators, okay, n number of correlators that may be there in the receiver structure. We are going to analyze the performance of these correlators in this for a memoryless AWGN channel, okay. I say memoryless, by that I mean that the channel does not have any memory in the form of inter-symbol interference or otherwise, okay. To start with, I have given recollecting an expression for the received signal R of t, okay, at the input to the correlation receiver altogether, and that we know is the signal, okay, and the corresponding noise sample function. And both these are defined over the symbol interval 0 to capital T. Okay, this is a known expression by this time. We have used it several times earlier. Now, this WT was a noise sample function, if you just to remind you, okay, from the capital WT noise process, which we are assuming as a Gaussian noise process. And we are also assuming that that noise process WT has a zero mean and a power spectral density of N0 by 2 watt per hertz. Okay, this power spectral density, incidentally, from this value expression itself, you should understand that it's a two-sided power spectral density that we are talking about. Okay, frequency ranging from minus infinity to plus infinity. So, if I quickly try to sketch it here, it is something like this. If it is f, we are saying that the noise is white and it has the same width everywhere for any frequency. Okay, and this value is N0 by Well, now we know that at the output of each correlator, okay, we will get some Rj, okay, which is a scalar quantity, and Rj is one component of the received vector R capital bar. You remember the expression for R bar, the received vector. If I have to show it in the signal constellation point, R, we know it as R1, R2 up to Rn. Isn't it? So, I am talking about Rj, one of these elements of this matrix. Okay. So, the general expression for Rj is this. We integrate in the jth correlator, okay, by the jth basis function, and ultimately we can separate out in the, I mean, we can visualize that as if it has got two components. Okay. One component is Sij corresponding to the signal which was transmitted, which was Sit. Okay. This portion is something I say deterministic. Okay. The second component is a random variable because it has been integrated and the value has been sampled at the end of t equal to capital T, the symbol duration. So, this is a random variable because of the noise. If there was no noise, I would have received only Sij. Okay. Now, we would like to characterize some statistical features of Rj, okay, because Rj will have some noise component in the form of a random variable. I can say that Rj on the whole is a random variable. Okay. So, you can observe that R of t, the received signal in time, is a Gaussian random process because it had a deterministic signal Sit added with a Gaussian random noise process. So, this whole thing now is a random process, okay, and the nature is Gaussian still. Mean etcetera will be different obviously, and these Rj's are Gaussian random variables, Rj I was talking about. And because Rj is a Gaussian random variable, we know from our limited knowledge of probability theory that it is sufficient, because the process is Gaussian, it is sufficient to characterize this random variable completely in terms of its mean and variance only. Higher order moments are not necessary, okay, though in general it is not true for any other distributions. Okay, for Gaussian distribution, it is sufficient to know the mean and the variance or the second moment for the process. So, I say that Rj is actually fully characterized by its mean and variance. So, when I said that I would like to characterize these Rj's R1, R2, etcetera, Rn, I now mean specifically that I have to find some expression for the mean and variance of Rj. Okay. Now, towards that, we now say that as WT, the basic noise process, is a zero mean random process, Wj also has a zero mean. Just think a little bit here. I am avoiding some mathematics in between, really. I am trying to touch upon the basic one, which may be necessary to develop the understanding, because this discussion will lead to some convenient expression of what we called earlier as some likelihood function, and that likelihood function we would like to use for our expression of error expression for various modulation schemes. Now, towards that, my point is that the Wt, the actual noise process which was changing with time arbitrarily, from which we have got Wj, small Wj here, this is one sample function observed over a duration of capital T, okay. This after integration is a random variable, okay. And now I am saying is that this Wj also has a zero mean, because the original noise process Wt, continuous time noise process, had a zero mean. Do you accept that intuitively? Yes, why not? Because this Wj, I am talking about the mean of Wj, okay. This mean is a statistical mean. So just imagine that you are observing the noise in a truncated manner over a duration of t, integrating it, okay, multiplying with the basis function and integrating that really, and consider now all possible noise variations over the duration 0 to capital T, okay, and then you are finding the mean of that. The mean also should be 0, okay. So intuitively it is okay that this Wj also has a 0 mean.
So that's only over a very large,
Number of noise samples you will have to find. So this mean, when I say this 0 mean, I am talking about a statistical mean. Okay, when you do not specify anything, it's a statistical operation I'm talking about. Okay, so here I'm writing E is a statistical expectation, basically, okay, of all possibilities of Rj. If I take that, then I can say expectation of Rj hence is expectation of Sij plus Wj. Okay, because Rj is Sij plus Wj, we saw just now, really, and then because expectation or mean of Wj component is 0 intuitively, okay. So this expectation of Rj is nothing but expectation of Sij, and what is Sij? Is a something, some fixed value really, isn't it? It's some scalar. So expectation of Rj, so I can say that the statistical mean of that received random variable at the output of the jth correlator ultimately is something fixed, mRj. Note that this is dependent, this is affected by the jth basis function, isn't it? But whatever it is, this is decided by the corresponding signal component Sij, isn't it?
Sir,
yeah.
How can
the
average of Sij be Sij?
Because Sij is some.
Of J, it should be independent of I.
No. It is the expectation of Sij, this expectation is the statistical expectation really. Okay. And then Sij is something constant. I am talking about the output of the jth correlator, jth path of the correlator bank. So that output is always defined, it's predefined basically. So that has to be something Sij only, isn't it? Because this does not vary. I am giving just a name, just another symbol, that MRJ, M to remind you that it's a mean. So I found an expression for the mean of Rj. So some part of characterization is over. The remaining characterization will come from an expression of the variance of Rj. So now let us see what is variance of Rj. I am giving a notation of sigma square of Rj, sigma Rj square. Okay. So by standard definition, this is the expectation of Rj minus Sij, where Sij is the mean of Rj whole square. And we see that the variance of that random variable at the output of the correlator is nothing but E of Wj square, okay, where Wj itself is a Gaussian random variable with zero mean. Now this operation, to be careful really, this is a statistical operation, okay. We should not try to carry out considering one sample function only. Actually, this is the expanded form of this. If I ask you tomorrow, after you have seen the noise sample function over one symbol duration of t, if I ask you to find expectation of Wj square, you should not hurriedly square it, square the observed value. That's going to be wrong because this is a statistical expectation, statistical averaging really. So you have to get back to the basic expression for Wj, okay, and this is the general expression, and you have to really in your expectation, in your mean operation, you have to include all possible sample functions of that noise process, okay. So that's what is taken is Wt here, this t and w small u, they are running variables ultimately. So as if I am considering one sample function of the noise process Wt, another sample function of the noise process, same noise process Wt, okay, and then as if multiplying them, okay. This leads to this expression, this integration operation is interchangeable, okay.
But sir,
yeah.
What does this signify, that we are considering one sample function integrated and the multiplying
yeah,
another?
If you are trying to find this statistical expectation, it is not sufficient to observe only one sample function. You cannot find a statistical average, but just by seeing one outcome of a statistical experiment. That's the idea, isn't it?
But the definition of,
pardon, yeah.
The definition of Wj is defined only on one.
No,
period.
Wj, as I said, is a noise sample function. Okay. Now, if you transmit, say, a signal with some Sij at the output of the jth correlator, you may get a noise sample function. After some time, if you transmit the same signal, you will get another noise sample function.
But that is included in the estimation.
So, pardon?
That is in the expectation itself. I mean, that is each Sj, Wj that we get will have their own probability.
Right.
And that is taken care of when we find
so, the so, when you find this is expectation of Wj square, how do you get Wj square basically?
So, by squaring the
by squaring the integral, that means you observe the process, okay, many times, okay. So you will find that this noise component Wj, if you could observe separately, okay, you go on observing various values of that, okay, multiply with, it is like this, the first squaring you need two values really. So whatever value you get in the first observation, you square it, whatever value you get in the second observation, you square it, like that, is it not?
Find out the, suppose x is a plain simple
notion,
and how do we find out
explanation
of x?
Just do x
square. No, not on that.
One issue which is getting missed is the correlation of this noise process scale. Okay, the most general expression should be like this. Let us just wait for some time really, it will come out automatically. So, I do this operation. This is the most general expression really. Now, interchanging this integration operation, I am trying to give a shape to this really. I am taking the basis functions on one side and putting this Wt, Wu, they are as if two different sample functions. It is something like, I mean, instead of carrying out one statistical experiment several times, as if I have got identical statistical experiments, many of them, they are occurring simultaneously, okay. They are statistical equivalent, I mentioned that long back really. So now again I can interchange the integration operation and the statistical expectation operation. By doing that, I get an expression for the variance sigma rj square in this form, where I have brought in the expectation term inside, and this expectation of two sample functions really, okay, should give me in general the, what is this?
Autocorrelation
function. And here I have used a rather general expression for autocorrelation function, okay, sorry, where I am also indicating the two instances when the two sample functions are considered really, okay, but this is not necessary. We know for this kind of additive white Gaussian noise in a memoryless channel really, this noise is a stationary process, which means that I need not use this general form of the autocorrelation function, and I can instead, yeah, tau, where tau is t minus u. The time difference I can say, okay. So considering a very stationary noise process, which is a very good assumption really, we can express this general expression for the autocorrelation as Rw t minus u or tau, one could put tau as well really. Now then I can find that my variance expression sigma rj square is integration, double integration of phi j t phi j u, the autocorrelation function dt du, okay. Now this my noise process I assumed as white and with the same power spectral density of n0 by 2. And you know that this autocorrelation function and the PSD, they are related. How? Yeah, they form Fourier transform pair, isn't it? Okay. So, can I say then that this autocorrelation function RWT minus U is n0 by 2 times the delta function, delta T minus U, because the corresponding power spectral density is n0 by 2 uniformly. Take the Fourier transformation, you get the power spectral density, okay, which becomes n0 by 2. This you have done as a general problem in mathematics while studying Fourier transformation, isn't it? If you have an impulse really, you take the Fourier transformation, you get a flat band really. It's, I'm using the same thing. So, this autocorrelation function is now in a very convenient form, it's n0 by 2 times delta T minus U. Now, try to think about it intuitively. RWT minus U, okay, is the autocorrelation function for the noise process. How is it if I ask you to plot for noise which is random? You will have an impulse at t equal to u, ACF will have a very large value, and at all other values, the value should be 0, ideally. Is it not? The autocorrelation function for a noise process, okay, would be an impulse, okay. When t is equal to u, you will get an impulse, and for other values, you will get 0, totally uncorrelated. Okay. Now, in fact, we had a somewhat closer, I should say, autocorrelation function description for the PN sequence that you have generated in the lab. In fact, I was asking you also about what is the autocorrelation function for the PNS output, PN sequence that you are getting. You know, that was somewhat close to this, but that was a pseudo sequence. Okay. So, we really did not get an impulse and 0 elsewhere, but we did have a high peak and some very small values, plus minus values around that. But the peak was very clearly distinguished, and moreover, because this whole sequence is limited, so it repeats, and hence the autocorrelation function also repeats. Okay, but for this noise process, it is not repetitive really. Okay, it's so random, it's totally aperiodic. So you get a perfect impulse function and a zero values at all other places, and there is no repetition really. So you get a single peak. Okay, so with this observation, let me get back to my expression for the variance sigma rj square. Now it is very convenient really. I have taken n0 by 2 outside because it is something constant. Okay. So it is double integration of phi j t phi j u delta t minus u dt du. And now you can very easily see that the overall variance reduces to again a very convenient value of n0 by 2. Okay. Fine, isn't it? This integration, if you carry out, you get n0 by 2 for all j's. Okay, this is independent of j, which correlator path you are talking about. Irrespective of that, for at the output of each correlator, the variance of the random variable rj, r1, r2, etc. is going to be the same. In fact, the variance is determined totally by the noise. It's n0 by 2. Okay. So, to summarize, yeah.
Integral to just to pi j t square dt.
Yeah, because delta t minus 2 is defined only for t equal to u. That's all. Okay. So it becomes phi j square t basically. Okay. Integration. Isn't it?
Yes.
Okay. So a quick summary is that for all j's, that means at the output of jth correlator, okay, we get sigma rj square is n0 by 2. The variance of the random variable that you get at the output of a correlator, irrespective of which correlator I am talking about, which path I am talking about, is the same and is dictated by the noise totally, and it is equal to the noise power spectral density n0 by 2. And the mean of that variable, of course, is different, is related to the corresponding signal component, okay, Sij. Fine?
So, but yeah.
As per this expression, it does not have. It does not have, yeah. So that's why it is something n naught by 2 only. It does not have any signal component. Okay. But remember that for practical implementation, we are assuming all through that the basis functions have been recovered properly and they are multiplied in exact phase, etc. And that's how you get. This is a somewhat ideal thing. You may not achieve it all the time really. Well, now let us think a little bit about a likelihood function. You remember when you talked about likelihood function? Anybody? Likelihood function and then some metric, yeah. In fact, while we were deriving the structure of a correlation receiver, we talked about what should be the expression really for an optimal detection scheme. Okay, and we started with some maximum a posteriori probability, then used Bayes relationship to get an equivalent expression in terms of maximum a posteriori probability, and ultimately for AWGN channel got the correlated structure, isn't it? Now, I'm talking about that likelihood function. I have reproduced the expression. Likelihood function is a probability, is a conditional probability. If you check your notebook, really, this is a conditional probability that if the mith symbol has been transmitted, what is the probability that I receive a vector r? This is the, okay. So, what is the probability that I receive r when the mith signal has been, ith message symbol, I am indicating the message symbol by mi here, has been transmitted. Equivalently, I could also write it as the probability that I receive a vector r, specific vector, when the ith signal was transmitted, conveying information about the ith message symbol. Now, in our present case, I can say that if I try to find an expression for this likelihood function, which is the conditional probability, what is the probability that I receive a specific vector r, given that the ith message symbol was transmitted, then I can write it in this form. Can anybody interpret this expression, this part of the expression? This is a product of several conditional probabilities. Yeah. That's one part which I have not discussed really. Think like this, you had some n number of correlator paths and the received vector consists of n components, okay, and you had n paths in the correlator, isn't it, multiplier and then the integrator, you are multiplying with the basis functions every time, and you had r1 here, r2 here, up to rn here, okay. The point is that this r1 is a scalar quantity, is a random variable, you saw, okay, is independent of r2. This can be shown, I am skipping that to save time really, by considering the covariance of rj's really, ri and rj. Intuitively, this is okay. My point is that whatever I receive at the output of the first correlator is independent of what I receive at the output of the second correlator. How could I say that? It's a memoryless channel. Yeah?
I mean, the memoryless means subsequent symbols.
Yes, they will not. Right. So, there is no effect of. Right. I'm coming. First thing, there are two issues. One is that the channel does not remember what has gone earlier. Okay. So, R1 is not at all influenced by what has appeared at this point, one symbol duration earlier and like that. That's one part. Second part is this, how are these basis functions related? They're perfectly orthonormal. They're perfectly orthonormal. And these received signal vector, the received signal vector consists of all these components basically. So, when in the correlator I am using this orthonormal basis functions, so long as these basis functions, the recovered basis functions in the receiver, they are still orthonormal, there is no reason why this component will have some portion in this, because again these are the components after showing them in the same orthonormal axis basically. Does it make sense? See, the only possibility is that R1, I can say, is a S11 plus W1. Similarly, R2 is S12 plus W2, like that. Now, there is no reason why S11 will have, the first part will have some contribution from S12 or other signal component, because in the transmitter they were orthonormal, in the receiver also they are orthonormal, because these basis functions have been received correctly. So, the only possibility that there could still be some kind of overlap is through this noise, etcetera. Okay, but that also is not there. Pardon? The channel is memoryless. The channel also does not remember anything about the previous noise and other disturbance.
But current noise?
The current noise, whatever is there, has been integrated. Okay, so you W1 is the resultant of when the overall noise is multiplied with the basis function, is correlated with the basis function phi1, isn't it? And the same overall noise has produced a component in R2. That's all. So this random variable, okay, is a random variable when it has been correlated with phi1, and the second random variable R2 is a, has got a component W2, which is random because of the W2, which has been obtained again by correlating with phi2, where the phi1 and phi2 are orthonormal. So at the final output, this output is no way dependent on the other output.
Sir, but
yeah,
like when we are deciding for the
yes. You have chosen
a particular point on the constellation diagram.
Right.
Now, if it individually, totally independently decide for the various parts, then it may correspond to a point which is not corresponding to a valid point in the constellation.
That, yes, that happens with many cases really. That happens usually, but that can happen only because of the second terms of W1, W2, W3, not because of the first terms. Because the process is additive. Huh.
So then, sir, because suppose I have decided for one of the RJs, my decision for the other RJs may be affected because of that, so that I get a point which is valid in the constellation diagram.
No, it is like this. See, please remember that in the correlated structure, we do not take any decision. We simply correlate the received signal with the corresponding basis function. Decision comes later. Is it not? So this R1 I get just by correlating the whatever I am received with one basis function phi1. So there is no decision involved as yet. So now my point is that irrespective of whether these RJs are related or not, even if for a channel with memory, I will get a vector R, and I can always map it in the signal constellation, in the signal space really. I couldn't understand why the point cannot be mapped there. It can always be mapped so long as I get a valid vector here, and I'll get a vector. My signal space is not bounded that way.
But it may not refer to a valid point which is being transmitted.
It won't, because of this noise component only. It will not correspond to, and that's why you have to take a decision subsequently. We decide in the vector receiver portion. Okay. Yes, yes, yes. We'll talk about that specifically after this. So, for this channel, AWGN channel without memory, this likelihood function, okay, I can express as the product of these individual likelihood functions, individual conditional probabilities, okay. And what is this individual conditional probability? This FRJ given MI, I'm using RJ here to remind that if I'm using all through to indicate probability here, RJ means the corresponding probability in the jth path, okay. So, if RJ given MI is the probability that the ith signal was transmitted, okay, and I have got the RJ scalar quantity, the jth component here, okay. And we saw that RJ, just now we saw that RJ is a Gaussian random variable, okay, with a mean Sij and a variance n0/2, okay. So, this is, I can say, given if the ith signal was actually transmitted, I know the mean of Rj, that is Sij. If Mj, the jth, some other symbol was transmitted, I could say that the mean of Rj was S, the corresponding S, the corresponding scalar quantity for the signal, isn't it? So, that way, this conditionality here only tells me about the mean of this Rj value really. And the variance in any case is decided by the noise is n0/2, okay. So, this conditional probability is nothing but this Gaussian PDF expression whose mean is known whose standard deviation is also known. The mean has come here as Sij, the standard deviation I am putting here in the form of variance here. Okay. So, this conditional probability is precisely the Gaussian PDF with known mean and variance. Then, yes,
PDF of FRJ given MI is same as F of RJ.
I could not talk about F of RJ. I could not talk about F of RJ in general. F of RJ means, say, in if I consider just for as an example two dimensional modulation scheme, okay, the corresponding R, the projection of R, the received signal point on the phi 1 axis really, what is the probability of that really, without any knowledge about which signal was transmitted. That is a rather complicated issue. We are not talking about that basically. What we are trying is that we are trying to find a convenient expression of the likelihood function. If the ith signal was transmitted, then what is this probability? Because if I know that ith signal was transmitted, then I know the mean of this RJ. That is what I am using here. For a memoryless channel, only you can express this as a product of this individual probability. Otherwise, there will be other probability components. It could not be simple probability, simple multiplication of the probability.
Simple, I mean, the product of probability, because they are independent, because the functions are orthonormal.
Which is orthonormal as well as the channel does not. The channel modeling that we are doing is simply received signal plus noise, okay, within that signal interval. That is the simplest, somewhat hypothetical model that we are using over here. There are many other channel models where one can add many other problems and can make the channel have some memory. So, specifically, I am rewriting that one. The conditional probability for getting the jth component of the received vector R, given that the ith symbol was transmitted, is 1 upon root pi n naught, okay, e to the power minus rj minus sij whole square by n naught. Okay. So, the likelihood function expression is this. Following that expression 10, the product of all these conditional probabilities, and here is the overall likelihood function for a received vector when the ith message symbol was transmitted. Okay. So, you can just find the product. The product has appeared as summation in the exponent here. The symbols in this expression are all defined. What is capital N? Number of basis functions that we are using, okay. N naught is the single sided power spectral density in watt per hertz, okay. Sij is the mean of the jth correlator output, okay. And Rj is what I got at the output of the jth correlator, okay. So, I can guess what is this difference even, Rj minus Sij, Wj, isn't it? So, this just you can think a little bit about this really, Rj minus Sij incidentally is Wj. Okay. Now, if I say if the noise process is such that there was huge noise and such that Wj is large, what does this mean to this likelihood function? Yes. So, the likelihood function, we know that in our receiver structure we tried to maximize this likelihood function. The receiver structure was maximum likelihood structure basically. And we can see that yes, the same principle is still valid here. It has to be really that if Wj is higher, this probability value decreases. Okay. So, this is a rough check that yes, this is okay. Now, we will use this likelihood function. This is a general description so far that we have done. Okay. We have not talked about any specific modulation scheme. Is that okay? We will apply this maximum likelihood function to find the expression for error rate, average error rate for some modulation schemes that we have studied so far. Okay. Just a little bit of summary here, that we use the concept of maximum likelihood detection, okay, the basic condition involving a posteriori probability, then involving a priori probability, okay, and then ultimately getting a correlation correlated structure. We use that already for determining the structure for the demodulator and modulator also, okay, for various modulation scheme. We are using the same structure once again for finding error expression, but we are not going up to the correlation receiver structure fully. That is not necessary. In fact, when you have to find the analytical expression for the error, etc., it is convenient that we talk about this likelihood function and try to get a specific shape of this likelihood function for a specific modulation scheme and then find out the bit error rate expression conveniently. We will have a first example in the form of BPSK, binary phase shifting, simple modulation scheme to understand, and we will try to use this general expression for the maximum likelihood function specifically for BPSK. Is that okay? Well, so it is a bit error rate calculation. BS stands for bit error rate. For BPSK, I can talk about bit error rate because one bit is equivalent to one symbol, okay, for binary phase shifting modulation. I have depicted the situation here. These are my two signal points, S1 bar, S2 bar. Now, somewhat loosely, you can say it is S1T, S2T, though that is not totally correct really. But we can say that, or say logic 1 is being transmitted by this point, is being indicated by this point, 0 is being indicated by this point, okay, and this point carries an energy of EB, so that this length is root EB, this length is minus root EB, all these things are known by this time. So these are the two signal points which are defined, okay, and this dotted line indicates the decision boundary. So Z1 is this side, okay, the right hand side, Z2 is the left hand side. What is the significance of this decision area? This decision zone or decision area is now going to assume more and more importance for error calculation really, okay. This Z1 decision zone means that if I have a received vector in this hub, we will say that I know that the received vector is closer to S1 compared to S2, isn't it, okay, and hence if the received vector is in this half, I can blindly say that if I can detect that the received vector is in this half, in the right half really, or in Z1, I can say most probably 1 was transmitted. Am I correct? Yes. Similarly, if the received vector was here somewhere on this side really, I would say most probably 0 was transmitted, something like this, okay. I have let the received vector be somewhere here, okay. Now, I can say that there will be an error in my decision making, though my decision making strategy is an optimum one, okay. Optimality does not mean that zero decision error, okay, that whatever error occurs will be minimum. That is the meaning of optimum decision making. So, consider that we are using a full correlation receiver structure with a correlation detector, okay, and then a vector receiver. Fine. So, the full optimum receiver structure we are using, and I have got a received vector which is somewhere here. Now, still there is a possibility of error, and there may be an error in making decision in the vector receiver if S1T was transmitted, but the received vector was in this zone, isn't it? Then that would be a case of decision error. So, when I am saying that I am trying to find out an expression for error rate, I am trying to consider what is the probability of that really, initially, isn't it? What is, how much is the probability that S1 is transmitted, but still we got a vector which is in this half, isn't it? So, error may occur for this case of BPSK in two ways. One is that S1T is transmitted and the received vector RT is in Z2. This statement is not fully, I mean, not 100% correct. Somewhat loosely, I have said that, but RT is in Z2. I should have told, said that R is in Z2, R as a vector is in Z2, which I have done in the next one. But many places you may find this description also. Okay, don't get confused. This means that the corresponding vector is in Z2 basically. So, this is one case of error, one way by which error can occur. The other possibility is that S2 was transmitted, but the received vector R is in Z1. So, these are the two possibilities. So, if I have to find an expression for the error rate, what I can do is that I can find the probability of this event, the probability of this event, and then can find out depending on what is the probability of S1 being transmitted, what is the probability of S2 being transmitted, and I can find the overall error rate, and that is what I am calling it as the bit error rate. Now, how can I define Z1? We can say that Z1 is defined by this, where this correlator output for the received vector, if it is 0. See, I can say the received vector R will be in Z1 if R is greater than 0. This is a scalar component. Is that okay? Similarly, we can say a received vector is in Z2 if R is less than or equal to I have included here, okay, is 0. Now, can I construct a likelihood function which will help me in finding the probability of these two events? My question here is, after describing the BPSK modulation scheme here and identifying the two possibilities by which error can occur, I am now interested in developing an expression for the likelihood function. Okay. Can I say that the corresponding likelihood function is like this? Is the probability that we received a vector R when S2 was transmitted, okay, that is one likelihood function, which more specifically with respect to this diagram means that we received the signal R of t at the input to the receiver really, okay, equivalently when message 0 was transmitted, S2 correspond to this point, isn't it, is the message 0. So, this is one likelihood function. I could write another likelihood function, isn't it? Now, I am considering one of the events where S2 was transmitted, that means 0 was transmitted, but I have received a vector, okay, and there will be an error if the received vector is on this right hand side, isn't it? This likely, pardon? 0 was transmitted, that is S2 was transmitted, okay, and this likelihood function will have a larger value if R is on this half, on the left half, it will have a lower value it is on, if it is on this half, and that is the error. Probability of error for the special case when 0 was transmitted and there was the received vector was on this side. This is the overall likelihood function. Yeah, okay, this is the overall likelihood function, R in this expression may be on this up, may be on this up, will have error if R is in this. Yes, you, but your, we do not know actually, we do not know, I am not claiming that we know at this point. Yes, yes, one has to consider, yes, so it, my story is not complete that way, okay, sorry. I do not know at the moment. I am finding an analytical expression for which this knowledge also is not necessary. Okay, let us see that. Now, we had a general expression for the likelihood function, isn't it? So, this likelihood function, that probability that S2 was transmitted and we have got a received vector R, I can again equivalently express it as that we have received a vector R when 0, message 0 was transmitted, 0 you can, is a logic 0 which was transmitted. Can I write that this is this by following my general expression? What I am doing is, for my specific BPSK modulation scheme, I am writing an expression for the likelihood function. Okay, a specific form of the likelihood function from the general expression really. Isn't it? This is a special case of the general likelihood function. What are the specialities if I just compare with this expression number 13? N is 1, okay, and then I is 2. So, for this likelihood function, this is a special expression, and ultimately by simplification, it is 1 upon root pi n naught exponential minus 1 upon n naught r plus root e b whole square. Okay. In fact, you will have only one value really. Okay. So, R is the corresponding scalar quantity, because you will have R on these lines, we do not have a second axis. for this description. Okay, so R is a scalar quantity. I defined R also, here also as a scalar quantity. Okay. So the conditional probability that the receiver decides in favor of 1 while 0 was transmitted, this is the expression for the likelihood function. I am now going to use this likelihood function for BPSK. I know the error event. Okay. So the conditional probability that the receiver decides in favor of 1 while 0 was transmitted, what is that? Is that overall probability that R is greater than 0, isn't it? So I am finding this overall conditional probability when R is greater than 0. So I am integrating this conditional probability from 0 to infinity, okay, over R, because that defines my this portion. 0 was transmitted. I am now finding what is the overall probability that I receive a vector on this half. Okay, and this half is characterized by R greater than 0. So I am integrating this conditional probability over 0 to infinity over R, isn't it? And I am calling this, you will find this notation is the probability of making an erroneous decision when 0 was transmitted. So the PE 0 here means the probability of decision error when 0 was transmitted. Because what is the zone of R which will lead to decision error? No, I am now considering, yeah, in general it is true, I am considering half of that. I am considering the S2 was transmitted, isn't it? I should also find out a similar expression when S1 was transmitted, okay, and what is the probability that the receive vector will be on the left hand side, isn't it? And one can guess that I need not really do that, it is going to be identical, isn't it? Because of the symmetry. So to find the probability of a decision error when 0 was transmitted is, we have to integrate this conditional probability over the decision region for which there will be decision error really, and that is the positive values of R in this case when 0 was transmitted, and the corresponding probability value I am calling as PE0. So you can do it yourself now, verify that it is correct. So the probability, let me write here, PE0, probability of error when 0 is transmitted is this, probability of a decision error is when the received vector is positive but actually 0 was transmitted, it should have been in the negative half, okay, for correct decision. So this is the probability for erroneous decision, and by simple substitution of variable, okay, one can see that this probability expression reduces to a convenient form involving complementary error function. Okay, we get some non-zero value here, root over e v by n naught up to infinity integrate e to the power minus z square by dz. Okay, I have multiplied by half to bring 2 by root pi so that you can identify the error function properly. And this whole thing is the complementary error function of root over e v by n naught. So the probability of making a decision error when 0 was transmitted ultimately is half ERFC root over e v by n naught. Is it easy to remember? One can also express in terms of the Q function, okay, where it is root over 2 e v by n naught, half goes, because the complementary error function and the Q function, they are related by this. Okay. Now, can anybody guess if from this discussion I could straight away write an expression for PE1, what would it be? Half ERFC root over EV by N naught. Okay. Now, if I write an expression of PE, which is the average bit error rate, can you give me an expression for PE? We have already an expression for PE0 and PE1. It is the probability of occurrence of 0 from the source times PE0 plus probability of occurrence of one from the source times the probability of making a decision error. Is it not? What is that? What is the probability of occurrence of zero from the source?
To
half. That was one of our assumptions, a robust assumption. So it is half p e 0 plus half p e 1 is equal to
half,
yeah, ERFC root over EV by N naught. So, PE or BER for BPSK, PE for BPSK is half ERFC root over EV by N naught. I want you to sketch this function, draw this function, okay, for different values of root over EV by N naught, okay, versus EV by N naught. Is that okay? So, the overall bit error rate expression, once we could find the expression for one error event because of the symmetry in the state and the signal constellation, the signal space really, we could get the overall expression very easily, okay. Now, following this procedure, can we, do we hope we can find the expression for the overall bit error rate or symbol error rate probability for QPSK modulation event? Following this approach, can you also find an expression for the overall symbol error rate, I won't say bit error rate at the moment, for QPSK modulation scheme or for binary FSK, it should be possible. The critical thing is that, you have to identify the decision region and the range of R, okay, the range of integration for the likelihood function. Once that is identified, sometimes in polar coordinates, sometimes in other methods also, you can segment the whole expression, decision region in several ways so that you can have simpler expression, okay. We will try a little bit of that in the next class. Thank you.